I don't think they're giving up on Omos. I think the reality is, though, you know, that Omos just isn't clicking as fast as they want him to. But
no,
it's, you know, we joked about it last week. It's, you know, he doesn't have the fire that you expect from a guy his size. You know, even though I still think he's a scary looking individual, but if he can't bring that to the ring, and even though they're throwing him 2-3 little white boys every week or whatever, it's just, right. You know,
yeah, he gets to beat up 98 degrees every week. It's just right, not gonna, right. it gets tiresome, but it's finally starting to level out with wrestling in general. And I think Vince McMahon being gone obviously was a big part of it, because Vince just didn't fucking care. Vince was like, sit down, read your script, monkey. This is what I want you to do, because I'm an old man and I know better, and fuck you.
Right.
But I think we're starting to realize now, or wrestling is, that you can't just put a plate of nothing in front of people and say, this is a person that's interesting.
Right.
Those times are over. The internet has completely made that, at this point, they've made that impossible. Right. Because now you can put on ESPN and watch somebody on there, and if they're not entertaining, you can go, you know, there's 100 people at least that are on YouTube that are doing sports news that are funny and entertaining and worth watching. And this is just a guy doing it out of his fucking basement with a green screen fucking Poughkeepsie.
Oh, yeah, yeah. No,
so sure. I don't have to sit around and listen to people who are boring. I don't have to sit around and be, lulled into complacency with this mediocre shit. I can go out and find people that are just normal people who happen to connect with me and have good opinions or are captivating. I don't got to wait around anymore. Right. So with a guy like Omos, yeah, it's like, well, he's not clicking with people. They got to move away from you, because we got to find somebody else. People are fucking right. Bored.
Quick, there's only, you know? So much you can do to try. And I mean, I will be fair. Giving him MVP was probably one of the biggest graces that they possibly did for both men. Yeah. You know, because MVP was on fire. Him working with the Hurt Business was fire. And arguably, he was our MVP of last year, because of all the work that he was doing, even with Cedric and everybody else involved. Like, he just made things so much better. And you took a guy like Bobby Lashley, who still is not a great promo by any fucking stretch of the imagination, and you had MVP dial in. He was a black Paul Heyman. And I don't mean that as an insult, and I'm not, like, you know, demoralizing the guy.
It's not an insult to say you're one of the best people to ever do with.
Wow. He was fucking amazing. And the stuff that he's almost had, like, a lot less talk time with Omos, and it almost feels like the character's incomplete. Like, MVP isn't happy where he's at, because when he was working with Bobby Lashley, you know, it was next level. It was a lot of fun. So yeah. I don't know what's going on. I don't know what's going on with Omos, and I agree with you. It's like there's only so much you can do with him, but he's such a larger than life person that I can see why Triple H and Stephanie and Nick Khan and everybody else that's involved with the creative process doesn't just want to give up on the guy.
Yeah, they want him to be. Why wouldn't you? You know what I mean? And especially if you're a good person, you're a nice person, you know, someone that's easy to work with, you're a good businessman, good businesswoman, whatever it might be. They want that to be successful. Why wouldn't you?
Of course.
You know what I mean? Like, dude, there's a reason.
Well, he's an attraction. That's one of the things we talked about before, about why Omos exists. Because, I mean, even in the beginning, people are like, oh, Omos can't fucking wrestle. There's nothing good about him. I'm like, he's still an attraction, dude. You're talking about somebody who's over 7 feet tall, scary, good heel, or at least supposed to be a good heel and stuff, you know? But I don't know. He also doesn't have a feud. They haven't even figured out a feud. I think that's also killing him, too. Yeah, like, there's nobody that's stepping up to Omos.
There's nobody that can rival him. There's nobody that can elevate him. This is a
well,
part
that's
of the
not
problem.
True, because him and AJ were great.
And
AJ was elevating him. So, I mean,
well,
it's
as
not...
a feud, there's nobody that's like, who's gonna step in. And the fact that they're slightly unwilling to take a guy like him and just say he gets to kill everyone. Like, that's what you got to do. You can't have a 7 foot fucking five guy bumping for people.
People are saying Braun. I disagree. And the reason I disagree with is Braun is at the rebuilding stage. if he beats Omos, I don't think he gets anything from it. I don't think he gets anything from
it. And Omos gets a pink slip at that point.
Yeah, Omos looks worse, and Braun doesn't really get much from it because there's not enough anger from the fans. There's not enough emotion behind Omos that would actually elevate anybody else. Omos is the one that needs to be elevated. Omos needs to do, and MVP too. They need to do something dastardly. I mean, and I know this is weird, but I'd say go back to Bobby Lashley. You know, do the storyline like, hey, we've been away from you for so long and we've got nothing but the worst from this company. We're getting the worst from the fans and it's all your fault. And go back after Bobby Lashley and start terrorizing him again. And I know it might feel like a retread, but he doesn't have any other connections. You can't, what are you going to do? Are you going to throw him in a match with Matt Riddle? Edge, is it going to be Omos versus Edge or Rey Mysterio versus, although I will be fair, I would love to see Omos versus Rey Mysterio just for the freak factor, but
that's it though, man, is you got to have something now. And I think that Triple H is going to make sure of that. Yeah. I think that he's going to be a guy that's going to, that's why, even though, by the way, I haven't paid attention to anything they've done with fucking Hit Row since they've been back. And I'm glad of that fact.
They've had a couple of songs and they come out there and tell everybody they're the best and then they leave.
And get no reaction, right? I'm assuming. Yeah. Well, big shock. But part of the reason why I'm sure Triple H brought that guy back was because in his mind, he's going, God damn it. I need some people that have some personality on the show.
Right.
I mean, by hook or by crook, at least these people have, I don't know, expressions on their fucking faces, you know, like there's something there resembling a personality. But yeah, the wrestling is needed to, you know, move itself back into that direction for quite some time. And I think, like I said, the internet as like a place where everybody is on some level interacting with, and for some basically living on, you can't get by with, to steal a fucking term from the kids, you can't get by with this mid shit.
Right.
You can't get by with these guys where it's just, even like I said, like fucking Randy Orton back in the, if Randy Orton was around today, I think he could get away with the Randy promos of 2005.
Actually. Yeah. Cause it sounds like
a legend killer. Oh,
I thought you meant the handsome Randy Orton.
The looks. Yeah. I mean, I think he'd be fine aesthetically. I mean, I don't think he's ever had a problem in that.
I'm actually 72.8% ready. I'm injury free. 72. Coming out with his fucking cast on, which was that was funny too. I enjoyed that. Yeah dude, these, even Randy Orton today, you know what? I still think he's charismatic to pull off a lot of it. The problem with Randy Orton wasn't the beginning. And it wasn't his recent stuff. It was the middle.
That middle was a long time.
It was. But I mean, in the beginning, his early stuff coming out with his dad and even doing Evolution. Yeah, he was good. We liked Randy Orton in the beginning. He was all right. Dude, him being champion and then how they fucking turned on him is when the middle began.
Wow, that was it. He had a lot to play off of. But I mean, like you said, that middle Randy Orton of him standing in the ring. I am the legend killer. Yeah. No one can live up to me.
But he even admits that. I've heard him doing interviews even admit that. He's like, yeah, I was asleep for a while, guys. You know,
it's like I didn't give a shit.
Right.
Jeremy
brings up a good point. I wouldn't be surprised if, that middle was most of the senior years.
That's true. You know? Yeah. It makes sense because you got to think to make another great old school sports analogy. At that point, Cena got to be Michael Jordan,
right?
And Randy Orton had to kind of settle for being Charles Barkley.
Yeah.
Which is actually a great comparison because Randy Orton was kind of like Charles Barkley. He's kind of didn't give a shit, said whatever he wanted to do.
More like a Dennis Rodman, don't you think?
Oh, yeah.
Because he was also hurting people too. So
that's a good point. Ryback was a little bit more of a Dennis Rodman.
Well,
no, but I mean, I think, it makes sense. I think that's it for him, because if you think about it, because Barkley at one point even said, he's like, listen, I'm never going to be the fucking guy as long as Michael Jordan's playing. Right. He's like, it just ain't going to happen. And I think that's what happened with Orton. I think Orton realized, he's like, I'm going to hang around. I'll be number two as long as this guy's out there and he's active, he's going to be the go-to guy. And I'm just, you know, whatever. I'm the handsome snake man with the fucking tribal tattoos. So I'll just do what I need to do to get my millions of dollars and go home.